Some 700 years before Jesus was born, the prophet Isaiah began preaching and teaching to the southern kingdom of Judah. At this time, God's people were divided, with 10 of the original 12 tribes comprising the kingdom of Israel in the north, and then the two southern tribes of Judah and Benjamin comprising the new kingdom of Judah. The nation of Assyria was a powerful threat to the people at this time, and they would eventually take the nation of Israel, the north, into captivity. Around this time, they're a major threat and a growing presence in the region, and Judah is worried, as was Israel before they were taken, of the danger that Assyria posed. And so they, as a government, as a people, decided that they needed to make alliances with other nations around them, namely Syria and Egypt. The prophet Isaiah writes to remind them that they are God's people, and that God has throughout history helped them through any problems that they have had. The people, however, choose not to listen and seek to turn to the nations around them for assistance. Isaiah bemoans the immorality of the people, the faithlessness of the people, and the corruption of the people and her leaders, and begs the people to repent and turn to God, lest a greater enemy come and take them. Of course, he speaks of Babylon, who at this time is a small, insignificant nation, but one day would rise to be a dominant power in the region and would take Judah eventually into captivity. As he writes, he makes numerous references to the coming Messiah, the man we know of as Jesus the Christ, and he peppers his writing throughout it with references to the Christ and to his kingdom and to the salvation that he offers. It is fitting that this author of the Old Testament book would write so much about the coming Christ, because his name, Isaiah, means Jehovah is salvation. It was salvation that the people of Judah were looking for. They were looking for what they thought was the needed salvation from Assyria. Instead, it was a salvation from Babylon that they should have been worried about. But even beyond that, a greater salvation was coming for them. They were going to go into Babylon. There was nothing they could do about that, because God knew the people would refuse to repent and turn to him. And so Babylon was coming in due time to take them. But a greater salvation was awaiting them. If those faithful ones would stay faithful, they would come out of captivity, return to their homeland, and would produce the Messiah, who would be the Savior of us all. Chapter 1 of Isaiah provides a fitting introduction to the 66 chapters of the entire book, a fitting introduction to the theme and to the subject matter that Isaiah will discuss. There's not much messianic references to it. Chapter 2 really is the beginning of that. Nevertheless, the foundation is laid that will carry the writer through the remaining book, which you can divide really into two primary sections. The first portion of the book is chapters 1 through 39, which concerns mostly the threat of Assyria and the coming threat of Babylon and the captivity that will follow with that. Not to mention numerous references and prophecies made concerning the Christ and his kingdom. Then there is an obvious shift in tone, a shift in topic, and a shift in writing style, really, to fit the topic by Isaiah, starting in chapter 40, going through 66, where he spends more time discussing the Messiah to come and the salvation that he offers. It has been argued by critics that there are as many as four, possibly, maybe even two different Isaiahs who wrote different sections of the book. That's false completely. John quotes in John 12, verses 38 through 41, a passage of Isaiah in the early part of the book and a passage of Isaiah in the later part of the book, and attributes both to the name Isaiah. If there is no inspiration, then there very well could be multiple Isaiahs. But if there is no inspiration, then the Bible isn't true and we're wasting our time anyway. But assuming the Bible is true, and we assume that because it only makes sense for it to be so, then we can only conclude that John was inspired, and John said that Isaiah was one person who wrote one book. And so there is just one book of Isaiah. In fact, the Qumran, or the Dead Sea Scrolls, contain a portion of the Isaiah text that combines chapters, what we call chapters 39 and 40, as one writing, which means as early as the 300s B.C., the writing was considered one complete text, as it should be, as it is one complete text. with two obvious division points, much like our Bible, which is one complete text, yet has two obvious division points, the first 39 books and the last 27 books, just like Isaiah has 39 chapters and a final 27 chapters in it. And in fact, the first 39 chapters of Isaiah are very Old Testament oriented, whereas the last 39 chapters, whereas the last 27 chapters are very New Testament oriented, speaking of salvation for all people. And so Isaiah itself is sometimes called the miniature Bible, with that division of 39 and 27. But as I said, chapter 1 really is a proper introduction to it. So let's study Isaiah chapter 1 and see how this wonderful work of inspiration begins. It starts with the prophet reading the vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Those kings mentioned at the end of the first verse are the kings that are on the throne of Judah throughout the time of Isaiah's writing. And he opens with the words, the vision of Isaiah. The vision, the word vision means revelation. Thus he states unequivocally that he is a man writing by the inspiration of God. The revelation that came to Isaiah, who is the son of Amos. Amos, who is the brother of the father of the king of Judah, Uzziah. And thus Isaiah is related to the royal family of Judah, which will make a text from Isaiah 7 make more sense. When we get to that, we'll notice that. But he writes to Judah and specifically the great city in Judah, Jerusalem, the epicenter of all of God's people. Verse 2, hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. God depicts himself in verse 2 as a mother who nourished, who fed, like mothers feed their children, this small and growing nation of Israel and later Israel and Judah when they divided. He pictures himself as a caring and nurturing parent who has been spurned by the child, who has been rejected by children, as he puts it here, Isaiah does, have rebelled against me, have turned away from, have gone rogue against them. He calls, O heavens and earth, sky and ground, all around to listen to the message that he has to declare, though it's specifically to Judah. He has words and writings in here which concern multiple nations and peoples for generations to come. Hear, O heavens and earth, God has spoken how I nurtured you and cherished and nourished you like a mother does children, and yet you've turned from me. Verse 3, the ox knows his owner, the mule his master's crib, but Israel does not know. My people do not consider. God says, you take these two very ignorant, famously ignorant animals, an ox and a mule, and how they are depicted in relation to Judah, and how they are seen as better than Judah. How so? Because an ox knows its master. An ox knows who owns it. An ox knows who it goes to be fed. A mule knows where to go to lie down, its master's crib. But Judah has forgotten. The end of verse 3. Israel does not know. My people do not consider. No, they don't put it in their mind. They have forgotten that God's their provider. My people do not consider. The word means to understand. They have stopped putting the pieces together and recognizing that God has been in the picture of their lives, that he has been the one to lead them and carry them all through their struggles and will do so again. They've forgotten that. They've really set it aside, choosing to forget that. So they are worse than an ox, worse than a dumb mule. Verse 4. Ah, or woe, ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors. They have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger. They are gone away backward. Ah, the word means alas, or woe to these people, to Judah, a people who are weighed down, laden, weighed heavily down by sin. They are so caught up in sin, he says. They've become a seed of evildoers. They have so engrossed themselves in unrighteousness that it's been bred into them, metaphorically speaking, that they teach their children by their actions to be evildoers as they are. Thus their children will teach their children. And this generation of wickedness comes about because these people refuse to follow God. They become a fruit of wickedness of evildoers. But then he says in verse 4, that they are children that are corruptors. That word means to decay. Thus, they're kind of fruit that as soon as you pluck it, it's already rotten. That's the kind of fruit that they're sprouting, this wicked nation. They have in their wickedness provoked. They have pushed to the breaking point the Holy One of Israel to anger. In other words, they have no one to blame but themselves for the punishment that God will deal out. Why? Because they have gone away backwards. They have gone so far away from God, they're moving backwards. They haven't just stopped. They haven't just slowed down. They're going the other direction. Verse 5, which begins really the first of three sections of this chapter, which concern the sin of Judah, the sanctification offered Judah, and the sorrow that Judah has because they won't take God's offer. But here we start with the sin of Judah in verse 5. Why should you be stricken anymore? You will revolt more and more. The whole head is sick. The whole heart is faint. God says, why do I have to keep spanking you? How many times must I keep spanking you, be stricken, until you learn your lesson? Why do I even bother spanking you? Because you just revolt more and more. You just rebel against me the more that I spank you. Like a stubborn, disobedient teenager, the more I punish you, the more you go away from me. Why do you do this to yourself? Why do you punish yourself so? I'm not going to stop punishing you, so you, by not listening and obeying, are only punishing yourself. He says that you revolt more and more, and then he describes the extent of their wickedness. The whole head is sick. He doesn't mean sick like with a cold or like with a sore throat. He means sick like wounded. Your whole body is wounded from the spankings that you've been delivered, from the punishment that's been doled out to you by God. Your whole head and heart is faint. Your head is sick. Your heart is faint. Your thinking is wrong. Your emotions is bad. Verse 6. From sole of foot to the head, from head to toe, there is no soundness in it. There is nowhere where there's not a wound. There's nowhere where there's not a bruise or a cut or a scrape that you've punished yourself with by provoking my hand. From head to toe, there's no soundness in it. Instead, there are just wounds and bruises, marks left behind from the punishment of God. And putrefying sores. That word means open sores. Sores that have not yet healed themselves before the next round of punishment has to come. They're doing this to themselves. They refuse to submit to God, so he must punish them by his holy nature. And thus, they just keep having these open sores. But notice, God is the one who has the medicine, if they'll just turn to him. Putrefying sores, they have not closed, neither bound up. God has the bandages, if they'll ask for it. Neither mollified, softened with ointment. God has the salve. God has the elixir in his medicine cabinet. If the people would just run to him, he would heal all their wounds. But they won't. They're too stubborn. Verse 7. Your country is desolate. Your cities are burned with fire. Your land, strangers devour in your presence, and it is desolate as overthrown by strangers. He writes in a past tense, yet he speaks of something that will come in their future. Why? Because a prophecy from God is as good as already happened. And so Isaiah can say, your country has become desolate, though it still is not yet that. Your city, Jerusalem, is not yet completely and utterly ruined, the word desolate means, but it will be. And thus he writes it like that. It is desolate. Your city's burned with fire, which is what a lot of people do, a lot of scavenger conquering nations do when they're taking the people out. They will scorch the earth behind them and desolate it, burned with fire. Your land, what's left of the soil which grows your crops, strangers devour in your presence. Those smatterings of people left behind, they will witness these scavengers, these dogs coming in, people swarming into this taken over place that has been left for dead, and they will watch them toil and take all of the reaps, to reap all the fruit that they have planted, they have worked and cultivated. This land that is their land, their promised land, the soil that they have worked and tilled, someone else will bear the fruit and enjoy it. Strangers will take it, he writes, overthrown by strangers. Verse 8, and the daughter of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, as a lodge in a garden of cucumbers, as a besieged city. What's left of the great city of Jerusalem? What's left of Zion, which refers to the mountain, but is sometimes broadened to refer to the whole city, or to refer to all of Judah, or even all of the promised land, Israel, Canaan, whatever. But here he speaks specifically of Jerusalem, this great city, the epicenter of the Hebrew people. the daughter of Zion, that is the extent of it, is left like a cottage in a vineyard. No more a great bustling town with a great population and a great culture. Now it's just a shack, the word means, a cottage in a vineyard. It's just a lodge in a garden of cucumbers, a besieged city. Your land has been taken over, and all that's left that you have to your name is just four walls that hastily were put up. The lodge in a garden of cucumbers refers to the kind of building that you would erect very hastily, intending only to keep it up for a short amount of time during the time necessary for the farmer to watch his crops carefully. In that very delicate window of time while he's harvesting this particular crop, he would build just a shelter from the elements, a shelter from the wind or the rain outside. And so it was quickly erased and quickly destroyed. That's all that's left of Jerusalem, a city that's that easily toppled. Verse 9, except you be destroyed, except the Lord of hosts had left unto us a very small remnant. We should have been as Sodom, and we should have been like unto Gomorrah. That word except, which opens verse 9, could be translated had not. We would be like this had not God left us a remnant. Had not we had a remnant among us. The word remnant means a survivor. Had there not been something to survive our people, a faithful few who will leave Jerusalem, leave Judah, go into captivity, who will stay faithful in captivity, who will return from captivity, staying faithful still, and will eventually produce the Messiah. Except the Lord of hosts had left us that very small survivor, we would have been like Sodom and Gomorrah, famous only for the fact that they're destroyed and for the sin that caused their destruction. You would have been just like that, Judah, if not for this remnant. You've been famous for your destruction and the sin that caused your destruction. Utterly laid waste like Sodom and Gomorrah was. And from that Isaiah turns in verse 10 to say, hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom. Give ear to the law of God, ye people of Gomorrah. He finishes the thought from the earlier verse of Sodom and Gomorrah and divides them up between the rulers, the leaders of the people, and the people. The leaders and the followers. It's really blind leading the blind, and both are going to be destroyed like Sodom and Gomorrah. So he appeals for both the leaders of the people and the people to listen, to hear. Hear the word of the Lord. Open your ears to hear more than what you're hearing now. Listen to God, you wicked people. Verse 11. Now he's writing, the prophet is, but this is the voice of God speaking. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me, says the Lord? I am full of the burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts, and I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of he-goats. I am sick to death of your worship, he says of them. I am tired, I have had it up to here, full of your vainly offered worship to me. You come to me with your wicked lives, with your wicked hearts, with your careless attitudes, and you think you can just offer fake worship. You can just go through the motions, do the actions, but have no heart, and think that satisfies me. Think of the arrogance of Judah, that they can live wicked, they think, from Sunday to Friday, and then on the Sabbath day, they can suddenly be pious. Or they think that they can go and they can offer their sacrifices, having been wicked up before, knowing they'll be wicked after, but as long as they just go through the bare motions of offering the sacrifice, they can grace God with their presence, you see the arrogance, that God will just accept it. But God never accepts ritual for the sake of ritual. He wants the heart to motivate the action. I delight not, he says, in these animal sacrifices. Delight not, or just delight, which is what he does in true worship. He delights in it. The word means to incline the head toward. It describes the physical nature of the relationship, rather, between God and his people. How he physically leans, metaphorically speaking, leans forward to his people, getting closer to those who worship him appropriately. These Judah people, they're not worshiping him appropriately. They're worshiping him vainly, and thus God is not inclining his ear toward them. He is pulling away from them. He delights not in what they're doing. Verse 12, when you come to appear before me, who has required this at your hand to tread my courts? Who told you I wanted you to show up before me in my presence to tread my courts with your ritual, with just doing it for the sake of doing it? Who told you that's what I want out of your worship? No. Bring no more vain oblations. Incense is an abomination unto me. The new moons and Sabbaths, the calling of the assemblies, I cannot away with. It is iniquity, even the solemn meeting. various different customs and aspects of the Hebrew or the Israelite way of life listed here in verse 13. Bring no more vain oblations. Don't bring any more empty offerings of worship. Incense. You think you can just wave a candle around, blow some smoke, literally, and that's going to satisfy me. Your new moons and Sabbaths, these days that I told you to set aside because you are a people set aside, you have certain customs and rituals that I want you to follow because I want you to follow them, but you've left me out of them. You're doing them just for the sake of doing them. Ritual for the sake of ritual. So these new moons and Sabbaths, they become nothing to me. I cannot away with. I can't stand them anymore, God says. The calling of the assemblies, all the times you come together and worship me, worthless. The solemn meeting, in other words, when you have these big feast days, three times a year, every Jewish male was supposed to return to Jerusalem to offer worship to God. And the apex of those weeks was the solemn meeting, like the seventh day of Passover, for an example. Well, God says those are worthless. You might as well not be worshiping me at all if you're going to worship me vainly. You might as well be offering swine on the altar if you're not going to offer true worship with a true heart. Verse 14, your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hates, disregards, thinks nothing of, the word means. They are a trouble unto me, means a burden, and I am weary to bear them. In other words, literally God has nothing that's too heavy for him to bear. He speaks like a person would, to figuratively speaking, to make us understand. All of these things that you offer, that you bring to me, this worship that is supposed to bring us close together, creator and creation, worshipped and worshiping, supposed to be brought together. Instead, it's driving us apart. It becomes a burden for me that I don't want to have to bear anymore, God says, having to put up with your fake and phony worship. Verse 15, when you spread forth your hands, I'll hide my face from you. When you make many prayers, I will not hear them. Your hands are full of blood. That tells them why he won't hear them or see them. The visual depiction is of the very cultural way in which these people prayed, with their hands open and their heads turned toward the sky. God says, you can look up to me as you pray to me, but I'm not looking down to you. You can open your hands intending to receive my blessings, but I have none to give you. I won't hear your prayers in order to answer them. Why not? Because your hands are full of blood. You offer hands to me that are blood-stained with wickedness. So he says, verse 16, wash you, make you clean. We're in the midst of the second of three sections of this first chapter. After the discussion of sin, we have the offering of sanctification, and that really climaxes right here in verse 16. Your hands are full of blood, so wash them, make them clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. You want to lift your hands so that I can acknowledge your prayers? Wash your dirty hands. Wash your hands of blood. Stop your evil doings. Don't think just because God emphasizes the heart in the previous verses that their doings were somehow okay. They've been doing wickedness for a long time. Their actions have been just as bad as their heart. Judah just thought they could live wickedly and then suddenly offer some vain worship and they would be okay. God says, no, your hands are bloody. In chapter 17, he offers a 5-point list of things to do in order for them to restore the relationship that they have with him. They've lost it by their wickedness and by their sinfulness. So he says, you want to have a relationship with me again? Here's what I need you to do. And this is also a very good illustration of what nations need to do if they want to be blessed as a people by God. 5 things listed here in verse 17. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. You do these 5 things and you can begin to rehabilitate your relationship with me, God says. First of all, learn to do well. It means make yourself find true happiness. That is, one that is found in God. The word well means happy, contentment. Contentment. They are seeking a worldly satisfaction. They want to make an alliance with all these nations around them because they're worried about losing their land, but they need to be worried about losing their relationship with God. The land will take care of itself if they get that. Learn to be content with what you have as given to you by God. After you learn to do well, seek judgment. Judgment means the decisions, in this case, of God. Seek the judgment of God. Seek the decision-making of God. Turn to God and listen to His will. And let that be your guide as a person and as a people. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Oppressed means those victims of violence. Help the hurt. Help those who have been hurt. Help those who are being mistreated, who are being abused, who are being attacked violently. Look out for those who are being hurt. Don't neglect them, as we'll see later in the chapter that that's exactly what's happening. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. In other words, discern who needs help and then actually help them. Find those who are too young to care for themselves and who, by various reasons, have no one in their family to care for them. Care for them. Help the helpless. Support them. And then finally, care for the elderly, he says, plead for the widow. Not just someone who's lost a husband, but someone who is old and unable to take care of themselves. Take care of them. These things were being neglected because they're so concerned with their own safety, they've forgotten to help the people in their land. And so Isaiah says, it's your heart that is bad. Help these people around you. Turn to God for guidance. And then he offers this great invitation in verse 18. Come now and let us reason together. Let us think and come to a conclusion, come to a decision about God and what is right for us to do. Let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Come now, he says, I invite you, let us reason together. Now it's the prophet's writing. He's the one inviting the people, but he speaks on behalf of God. God is inviting me to reason, to use my common sense, and to see that he is the way out of my problems. Though my sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. They're red, stained with blood, as he said my hands were, but they can be white as snow, clean. They are red like crimson. That's a worm that was indigenous to that region, a red worm. Disgusting picture of a worm crawling around in the dirt. That's what your soul is like, but it can be white, as pure as sheep's wool. If ye be willing and obedient, there's a contrast here in verses 19 and 20. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat of the good of the land. Eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured. You can eat or be eaten. Verse 19, if you be willing, if you have an intention to submit to God, and obedient, if you actually follow through and submit to God, then you shall eat the good of the land. Your land won't be destroyed. You'll get to eat and enjoy it. But, verse 20, if you refuse, if you rebel, you shall be devoured. You'll be the one who's eaten, completely consumed by enemies with the sword, devoured with God's vengeance, the sword is. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. This is his promise. You can either take it or leave it. You can either submit to God or reject God. Either be destroyed or be blessed. Now we turn to Isaiah and the sorrow of Judah here in verse 21 through the end of the chapter. Isaiah starts with a look at contrast of what Israel was versus what they've become. How is the faithful city? He says, oh, just look how. How has the faithful city become a harlot? You were once a faithful bride to God, and now you are a prostitute, gone away from God. It was full of judgment, righteousness lodged in it, but now murderers. It was a land that used to follow after God's decrees, full of judgment. They decided to do what God said to do, but now murderers. They follow after their ways. Righteousness used to live in that city. Now murderers live in that city. Thy silver is become dross, verse 22. Thy wine mixed with water. You once were pure silver like a coin, worth great value to God. Incidentally, Israel was only valuable to God. They were small, insignificant, and worthless to everyone else. The Egyptians had them as doing meaningless slave labor. They are of no value. They have no great strategic importance in that region or geopolitically in any way, but they were valuable to God so that through this tiny, insignificant nation, God could produce the Messiah and he could get the glory he deserves for doing so. They were only valuable to God, and they've thrown that value away. They were a silver, pure coin, but now they become dross. Dross, and he'll later say dross and tin, is the material that the scum that forms on molten metal when you burn it at a high temperature. And they scoop and scrape that scum off, and all that's left is the pure metal. They were once the pure metal, now they're just scum that was discarded. They were once pure wine, a pure tasting drink, but now are mixed with water. And there's a possible translation of this word water could mean urine, which would be a stark contrast. You were once pure wine, now you're urine. Or it's just pure wine, now you're watered down. That Either way, the meaning is the same. You were good, and now you've gone so bad. Verse 23, now he rebukes their government. The princes are rebellious, companions of thieves. Everyone loves gifts. Everyone follows after rewards. They judge not the fatherless, neither does the cause of the widow come unto them. Your leaders are rebellious. How do they rebel if they're the leaders? Rebellion means you're rebelling at someone greater than you. God's their leader. God is the true king of Israel. Everyone who sits on the throne and wears a crown is just a steward. They wear the title, but they have no authority. God's the authority. Thus they are rebellious, these leaders are. They're the companions of thieves who shake the hand and smile and who hold bribes in the other in order to get their way. Every one of your leaders, they love gifts. They follow after rewards. In other words, they go where the money is. They love getting a bribe. No one wants to serve God. They judge not the fatherless. They don't help the helpless. Neither does the cause of the widow come unto them. They don't hear the pleas of those who need assistance. They're too busy getting bribes, following the money. Therefore says the Lord, verse 24, the Lord of hosts, the mighty one of Israel, ah, I will ease me of mine adversaries and avenge me of mine enemies. Therefore, because you people are so wicked, you refuse to repent. Here's what God says. Here's what the Lord, Adonai, here's what the Master, the Lord, Jehovah, your God of hosts, the mighty one of Israel, the one who soars above Israel. Here's what he says. Ah, or woe, I will ease me of mine adversaries. He called them a burden back in verse 14. Now he says, I'm going to unload that burden. I don't need this problem anymore. Judah, you're just a burden to me. I'm going to set you down. I don't need you anymore. I will set you down and I will avenge you, avenge me rather, for your wickedness. Avenge me of mine enemies. And I will turn my hand upon thee. That's not the hand that gives. This is the hand that strikes. This is the hand of punishment. Turn my hand upon thee and will purely purge away thy dross and take away all thy tin. Again, dross and tin together is that scum on molten metal. Now the picture sounds bleak, but this verse is actually optimistic. It's actually positive. What God is doing here is not rashly lashing out on the people. He's not just discarding them willy-nilly. God is saying, I'm going to do some purging here. I'm not going to annihilate you from the face of the earth. I'm going to purge from you the wickedness around you so that all that's left is the silver again. And from that pure silver, that remnant from verse 9, the Messiah can come. Verse 26, and after he's done the purifying and purging, he says, I will restore thy judges as at the first. I'll have people there who listen to me like used to be. I will restore judges at the first and thy counselors as at the beginning. There'll be people who care for their fellow citizens like they used to have. Afterward, thou shalt be called the city of righteousness, the faithful city, which is the contrast from verse 21. You were faithful, now you're a harlot. You were righteous there, but now you have murderers there. He says, I will do this purifying, this purging. I'm going to burn Judah, and what's left will just be the pure silver, which will be righteous again. Verse 27, Zion shall be redeemed with judgment. Redeemed, something bought with a price. The price for Judah's restoration is Judah's punishment in Babylon. When they get out, they will have been burned and purged thoroughly. So they will be redeemed with judgment and her converts with righteousness. All that will come out, all that will be left after the captivity are those who want to listen to God and do right by God. Judgment and righteousness. And the destruction of the transgressors, those who go in, or those who are in the process of going in, those wicked ones who are causing this problem in the first place, the destruction of the transgressors and the sinners shall be together, and they shall forsake, they that forsake the Lord shall be consumed. The destruction of the wicked will be just as sure as the restoration of the faithful. The destruction of the transgressors, those who step away from righteousness, and those of sinners, those who rebel against righteousness, both together, those that forsake the Lord will be consumed, completely devoured, completely burned away. Verse 29, for they shall be ashamed of the oaks which they have desired, and they shall be confounded for the gardens that they have chosen, that you have chosen. These idolaters in Judah, these wicked people who rebelled against God and who now follow after pagan gods, they take the oak, they carve the wood into an idol, they set it in a beautiful, luscious garden that they have tended and cared for, and they have groomed to make sure that it's as beautiful as it can be to set this dumb idol in the middle of. And God says, you love the oak, you love the garden, but you don't love me. You're going to one day be ashamed of that oak. You're going to be embarrassed or blush, confounded. You're going to blush at thought of that garden that you once planted for that idol. Verse 30, for you shall be as an oak whose leaf fades, and as a garden that has no water. You love the tree? I'll make you a tree, but you'll be one whose leaves wither. You love the garden? I'll make you a garden, but it'll be one that gets no rain, and thus nothing grows. Last verse of the chapter. And the strong shall be as a tow, and the maker of it as a spark, and they shall both burn together, and none shall quench them. The tow is the little strands at the end of ropes and things that were ripped off or cut off, and they were used as just a fire starter, just kindling. He says, your strongest men will not be able to stop what's coming. What I'm going to do to you, you cannot stop. The strong will be like the tow, ripped and cast down, and the spark, the maker of the spark of the fire that you're going to burn yourself with, is Judah itself. The maker of it is the spark, and they shall both burn. The wicked people and the leaders of those wicked people will be the spark that burns together, and none shall quench them. You're not going to be able to put out this fire. The punishment that God is going to send to Judah will be so severe, it will be so swift, and it will be so long-lasting, they'll have no way to argue that it was anything other than punishment from God. They can't say it's just a run of bad luck. What they're going to experience has been prophesied. And when it comes to fruition, they'll know it's by their own undoing, but by their own hand, that was their undoing. That's chapter 1 of Isaiah. I'm sorry my voice was no good. I lost it recently. But by the time I teach Isaiah chapter 2, my voice should be much better. But we'll pick up Isaiah chapter 2, which is the first real introduction to the Messiah in this text, this time, next time. Until then, thank you so much.